This morning I would like to start with some comments on the topic of fatigue. We can't get very deeply into the subject because fatigue is a whole world, a whole universe, and we have been doing fatigue investigations since the last 150 years, and I guess it's millions of publications that have appeared in the subject, and still now the processes of fatigue are not yet well understood. In the sense that we can predict fatigue behavior accurately enough for every case of application. Well, to make the long story short,
this comes to us here.
It doesn't help you when I see my view graphs here on the screen. Again, what I just was saying, we will just briefly look into some details that we need for the next step when we try to set up methods for the assessment of structural components. And this is the usual thing that you probably learn in the first or second semester. We have usually a sine wave because this is most easily to be generated. The applied stress varies like this here, and most investigations are being done for a constant stress amplitude because it's very easy. Number one, it's very easy to apply to a specimen. Number two, when you vary the amplitude, then you run into a jungle, and most probably you won't find the exit. So here we have the stress. We need this definition a little bit later, the minimum stress. What is important is the complete variation, delta sigma here. This is what changes, what varies during the loading cycle, and this is the important parameter, delta sigma. Fatigue is quite a complex process. And when we look, well, usually when we do an SN curve, you know, SN curve or Wöhler curve, we measure one quantity, that's the load cycles to failure, which is much too little for such an important experiment. Just the load cycle to failure. I mean, it's an important information, but it is not enough. You don't understand anything. In the beginning, people have thought, during the cyclic loading, the material is somehow degraded, it is no longer as good as it used to be before the load cycle was applied. And it turned out that this is not correct because when we look closely on the specimen, then we see that cracks are initiated, very small cracks, then cracks propagate and become, here the microcracks propagate. And so you may guess that the microstructure of the material is a controlling property, and then the crack grows so big that we can see it with the naked eye, we can do measurements. And the important parameters are temperature, frequency, environment, of course, and growth history. This is still kind of a. Now, also this is something that you know. This is a simple Zen curve, and here I started at 10 to the 4th, 10,000 load cycles. And the interesting thing is that in double logarithmic coordinates, we find, if you look at our data points, kind of a straight line, and straight lines in double logarithmic coordinates means that we have a power law, and power laws are always easy to deal with. And fortunately, in our case, a load cycle below which, obviously, the specimen of the material lives much longer. And here we have a knee in the curve, and this happens at about 5 million load cycles. And the idea is that whenever we are below this stress amplitude, our material lives forever. And this is how usually design is being made. Now this is dead wrong, unfortunately. In the, maybe it's about 20 years ago or so, when people designed new test machines operating at extremely high frequencies. You know, here, 1 million load cycle, 10 million load cycles, or usually 50 hertz machine, it takes quite a time. When you go beyond by another or even two orders of magnitude, then the test duration is quite long and the tests are expensive. So people design the test machines based on ultrasonic vibrations, so you can have a very high frequency. With the drawback that there is the risk of heating up the specimen, so it's not very good for polymers, but it's appropriate for metals. And then people found, unfortunately, yesterday I told you that I don't want to talk about things that I haven't done myself. This is something that I haven't done myself, but I know from my colleagues. When you go beyond here, you find a further drop, so there is no infinite life. I mean, if you have ever dealt with physics, you should have come to the same conclusion, nothing is forever. And I'm not about degradation by environmental effects, but it's really true that there is no infinite life. But this can be a kind of a concern. Now, this is typical of steels, aluminum, or non-ferrous alloys, I should say. Non-ferrous alloys usually lower fatigue strength. And the knee here is about 1 order of magnitude greater here in terms of load cycles. But here we see all constantly that the SN curve drops slightly, so there has never come up the idea of infinite life. We have tried to compile the effects of some important parameters. And what we touched upon already yesterday, when we vary the strength, but where the strength of a material is the first design quantity. You do a design, be it a bridge or a gear shaft or an automobile or whatever it is, the strength of the material, you start with the strength of the material. And then when we have fatigue loading, which is usually the case, we are interested in the SN curve or in the endurance limit here, and we quickly find that the fatigue strength fortunately increases with the tensile strength. So it makes us happy for the moment. But this is the trend of the SN curve when we vary the strength of the material. As a rule of thumb, we can say, if we don't know anything, we can say that the endurance limit of a steel is roughly one half of its ultimate strength, of its tensile strength. For non-ferrous alloys, it's roughly, depending on the material, 35% to 40%. Now, the next point is the test frequency. People are concerned about a possible effect of test frequency even in laboratory air. Of course, it is useful to test with a high frequency as possible to keep the test duration low. And so we have resonance machines going up to maybe 100, 200 hertz. And indeed, even in laboratory air, we find not a peak, but a slight effect of frequency, which means at higher frequency, we get something somewhat better fatigue properties. And you may ask, so what? High frequency is positive, but our engineering component or system may be operated at a lower frequency. So we would be on the unsafe side, on the non-conservative side. So there is a small effect of laboratory air. Now here, this is a popular, shock pinning is a popular method to increase the fatigue properties of the material. Shock pinning is being done either with little glass balls or steel balls, and it is shot with an air gun onto the surface of a test piece or later on the structural component. And the effect is the following. We insert plastic deformation into the surface layers of the specimen or component. And plastic deformation, we know that we have strain hardening of the material. Plastic deformation leads to higher strength locally and thus to higher fatigue strength, plus we introduce residual stresses, negative residual stresses, and they are superimposed on the applied stresses, so we have a very positive effect. And shock pinning can be easily done on site, which means when you have a large structure, maybe an offshore component or whatever it is, or ship hull. You don't have to do this in on small pieces in a workshop, but you can do it on site. And so this is a very, very positive, very good effect. If it's not overdone, if it's being overshot, which means with too high energy, with too long duration, there is a risk that we introduce small cracks and then your fatigue properties have gone. Notches or stress razors. This is the starting point here. The broken line is always the starting point, like here, so the unpeened and peened material. And when we have notches or stress razors, like I mentioned briefly yesterday, we find, except for very low load cycles, we find a detrimental effect, and notches decrease fatigue strength of the material. And the effect, of course, depends on the acuity or sharpness of the notch. The sharper the notch, poorer fatigue properties. We'll get back to that a bit later. Now, corrosion environmental effects. The broken line here is the starting point, the SN curve measured in laboratory air, and you do the same kind of tests, for example, in seawater. By the way, seawater is a 3.5%. Salt water is a popular reference environment. Don't ask me why. It is obviously it mimics many actual environmental effects. And the interesting thing is that materials that have to be qualified for aeroplane applications have to prove their properties in 3.5% salt water. Now you may say, I have never seen an aeroplane floating in water. Why does this make sense? Number one, we have aeroplanes flying in tropic areas, which hop from island to island and frequently don't reach very high altitude. And you know that in tropical areas, the air is kind of salt rich. And so there is salt in the air. But this is obviously not the main effect. You may have noticed that when you fly in an aeroplane, something liquids are being spilled, and they are collected at the lowest part of the fuselage. They form kind of a bilge, or it's coffee, Coca-Cola, leaking toilets, and all these things. So this is. I was told this is really an awful mixture. which is obviously nicely mimicked by 3.5% salt water. So that's where it comes from. There's another point that I learned a few years ago, that some aeroplanes, a certain class of planes, corrode while they don't fly. And this is has happened or has been investigated in the US on planes of the Navy. I mean, the Navy doesn't just have ships, they do also have planes on the carrier, of course, but their airfields, of course, are close to the coast. And most of the time they are sitting on the runway or somewhere else on the airbase, and it is there where these planes rust, simply rust. Okay, but without fatigue going. Now, the bad thing is that number one, corrosion is a detrimental effect, and number two, of course, there is a frequency effect. When the loading frequency is low, there is very little left. Very little left. And some frequencies, some operating frequencies are very low. I mean, here, this is also life and structures, but I have also a little bit of experience with the more hardware stuff. For offshore platforms, when you want to qualify, at least for the North Sea, when you want to qualify something for offshore platforms, North Sea applications, then there is a standard test frequency of, if I remember correctly, 0.05 Hertz. When you do a fatigue experiment, fatigue cut propagation, as we did in the past, it takes a lot of patience and the stable test conditions, and it takes really weeks to set up a crack propagation curve. Okay, so this is the quite schematically the effect of corrosion, and there's also the effect on the mean stress, which means it is not only the cyclic stress, the variation delta sigma that matters, it is also the mean stress. So things are getting complicated. The more deeply you look into the subjects, the more complicated. Fortunately, so scientists have a lot to do. And with increasing mean stress, we find that the fatigue strength goes down. Okay, so this is just a brief overview and, on fatigue behavior. And here is something that I mentioned already yesterday. Once again, the intrinsic limit of a material increases with its strength. That should be overdone. People have, of course, already also tried to use Martin sitting steel, really hardened, very hard Martin sitting steel, which theoretically should have a high endurance limit, but these hard specimens can be difficult to clamp properly in the test machine to avoid any bending effects. So this doesn't make much sense. But when we introduce notches or stress razors, then the endurance limit of fatigue properties go down. And we will see that again, I guess, today in terms of fatigue cut propagation curves. Now, I was saying for setting up an SN curve, we don't do anything else than measuring the load cycles to failure. But when we look closely at a petrographically polished surface, then we will find that after a while we have one of a few micro cracks within a grain, for example, just within grains. And with increasing number of load cycles, these cracks, initiating cracks, start to propagate or extend until the specimen fails. So the fatigue process is one of formation and propagation of cracks. In the end, it is one crack that dominates, and that crack brings the material to failure, full stop. the material around the crack is not damaged. So it is the previous thinking, the original thinking, that the material somehow gets worse is wrong. And in fact, one of my colleagues in Karlsruhe did an interesting experiment. He used a big copper specimen and he fatigued it until he saw small micro cracks on the surface. Then he polished away the cracks, fatigued the specimen again, and again and again he repeated these cycles, and so the fatigue life of that specimen was incredibly long. In the end, it fades because you form internal cracks. The internal cracks are the reason for the downfall of the fatigue curve beyond endurance limit. But it's really true. It is for normal purposes, normal circumstances, it's the cracks formed at the surface that kill the material. So in my view, fatigue testing is a surface test, test of the surface quality. Otherwise, surface treatments like shot peeling wouldn't work. Okay. Now, how does damage develop? I've tried several kinds of realization. Here we have micro cracks. And cracks beyond the detection limit of NDI. NDI is non-destructive inspection. Sometimes people use NDT, non-destructive testing, usually with ultrasonic methods. And there is no conflict with what I said previously. I said when you look at the specimen surface, we find micro cracks, but in operation of the component is usually not polished. I have never ever seen a polished component running somewhere. So this is the behavior we can find for a component in service. We have short crack propagation, we can't see it. Then there is a detection limit of our NDI method, and finally the crack propagates and the rate is ever increasing, unfortunately, until the whole thing fails. Now this is an interesting diagram set up by Jaap Staver, one of the pioneers in aerospace fatigue. And I'd like to discuss this in more detail. Here we have percentage of life. So here starts the cycling, and this is failure. Here we have a size scale from the old measures in Armstrong, 1 millimeter, micrometer, 10th of a micrometer, 1/100th of a micrometer. So this is atomic size already, and until the whole thing gets microscopic. When we do a test on polished specimens, so we will find, we should be able to find by electron microscopy, for example, very small cracks. And they grow slowly, and in the end, when the specimen fails, we have reached 100% of life. Now this is supposed to be valid for a metal without any hard faces. It's a pure metal or interstitial alloy or whatever alloy, but without any hard, substantial hard faces. When we have big inclusions, like the ones I showed you yesterday in the micrograph, then these inclusions are poorly bonded to the metal matrix. In other words, we do already have a micro crack, which is present before we start cycling. And so life starts with damage, okay? In the order of 10 or sometimes 20 microns, yes, or it was almost 100 microns. And so the whole life is shorter. I mean, this is in percent, so this is normalized, but the whole life is much shorter. I will show you something at the end of this topic, and how we can predict behavior of the presence of inclusions. But you can have, in the beginning, you can have a real defect on the surface, maybe by the mounting process. I was told that in the early days, when the first lightweight wheels on automobiles and sports cars were used, as far as I remember, they were even made of magnesium, not aluminum, but of magnesium, to lower the unsprung weight, of course, to improve the road holding of the sports car. And some of these failed by fatigue, much to the dismay of the producer, of course. And driving your car at high speed and your front wheel brakes is not so funny. And then it turned out that during the process of attaching the wheel to the car, the workers were used to give it a final stroke with a hammer, which had caused no problems on steel wheels, but magnesium is relatively soft, as you know, and so small notches, small stress raisers were created, and that led to fatigue failure. And or there can be other kinds of scratches, and as you can see, if you compare this and that here, crack propagates immediately, relatively fast, and life is short. So this is not so pleasant. So going a bit deeper into the subject, this is supposed to be a section through a specimen. Here we have the surface, and this may be the grain that is most prone to the formation of fatigue cracks. And in metals, the formation process has been quite thoroughly investigated. It is simply a consequence of plastic deformation. Before you see any cracks on the surface, you see fine dark lines, straight lines, which are traces of plastic deformation. It's there where the slip plane leaves the grain of the surface, and a single load cycle gives you maybe one Burgers vector on the surface, something that you can't see, but when you apply thousands of load cycles, thousands of dislocations leaving the material, then you get little steps. The steps are not very clear cut, but it is kind of steps. And if you think in quality of surface, the surface is no longer as smooth as we wish it to be. So this is a minute stress razor, and it is there where the micro cracks are formed. And so this red line here is identical with the trace of a slip plane, 111 plane in face center cubic metals. And so the crack propagates along this slip plane here. And when it reaches the first grain boundary, it may stop forever. Why could it stop? You have an idea why it doesn't propagate? I mean, it's the same material. Why does it stop? I mean, if the stress is low enough, of course. Why does it stop?
The other grain has a different orientation.
This is probably the most important reason. Yeah, you have the adjacent grain may have a different, usually has, otherwise it wouldn't, there wouldn't be a grain boundary. It's a different orientation. So there is no continuity between the slip lane in the first grain and the slip planes in the other grains, in the adjacent grain. And if the stress is high enough, enough energy is consumed here at the grain boundary that the crack then is driven further. Sometimes we have enrichment of alloying elements, which can also be an obstacle. Okay, so most of the cracks may stop here. And so these are
dormant or non-propagating cracks.
But maybe one or a few cracks just slow down, until they manage to overcome the difficulties here, and then crack propagation is really,
it can no longer be stopped when we continue, when you keep on cycling.
So this is a very schematical way what happens. So I have shown here just one non-propagating crack. In fact, we have several ones. And so this is the basic mechanism. And now, there is some definitions. The definitions are a bit arbitrary. Some people speak of microstructurally short cracks when the crack size in the order of a characteristic microstructural parameter, for example, grain size, and the propagation is affected by the local microstructure. I don't agree with this second definition. I think it is wrong because even when we have a long crack at low rates, it is also, as we will, I think, see later, I have a diagram, is also affected by the local microstructure. But this is the general definition. Microstructural short crack cannot be characterized by continuum mechanics. If you would try to do it in a very appropriate way, we should use crystal plasticity theories. And people have done that. It is quite cumbersome, but it is scientifically very, very challenging. So we have delay and acceleration effects, what I showed you previously, for example, near grain boundaries, and below a certain stress, the crack is arrested. And this is an important thing here. The first grain boundary is the first area, and it characterizes the endurance limit. The endurance limit is not, against popular thinking, as opposed to popular thinking, is not the stress which causes no cracks, but it is that stress which causes non-propagating cracks. Cracks that may stop at the first grain boundary, but it could also be macro cracks, large cracks. We have endurance limits for large cracks later. So this is important. So the so-called mechanically short crack, their size is in the order of a characteristic mechanical parameter, for example, plastic zone size. And the grain has propagated such that it's, crack has propagated such that its front covers several grain sizes. And it can't be correlated with the stress intensity factor. We also have delay and acceleration effects. And also in this case, below a certain stress amplitude, the crack arrests. And this is the second barrier we will see. This is a diagram which characterizes the threshold of macroscopic, also macroscopic crack propagation. Now, fatigue until maybe about 30 years ago. The mechanisms of fatigue could not be prescribed in a quantitative manner. It was the advent of fracture mechanics that enabled us to treat fatigue if there are any cracks, which you don't like, but if there are any cracks, you can treat the fatigue progress quantitatively and in a predictive manner. So this was a great step forward. Now, how does this work? Some of you may already be familiar with that, so excuse me when I have to repeat all these things here. This is the stress sign we saw previously. Here is the delta sigma. And we convert this to a stress intensity factor cycle, This is another load cycle which scales directly with delta sigma, because a delta k is a cyclic stress intensity factor. It's simply nothing else but the cyclic stress here times square root pi, 2 pi a, and times our calibration function here. And it is now that I need the blackboard again. I would like to show you on the blackboard
what is that one?
You have to pack your fingers.
This was called Harris' law.
And in physics, a law is something very fundamental. I mean, this is not a law, this is a relationship. But people were so happy that they called it Paris law. And Paul Paris had a typical American career, becoming quite famous by his discovery here. He retired from his university, he set up his own business. He obviously made some money because he bought in California, he bought a vineyard, and he's dealing with wine, so it's absolutely interesting time. He's still active. Now, but life is not that easy. When we are, for example, when you are more patient and doing tests with lower stress amplitude, we reduce, maybe here somewhere here in the diagram, and reduce the applied stress slowly in order to see how far this goes down. I mean, it must start somewhere. Then it happens, and the curve falls down here, which obviously gives us, I think I did my color chalk. And we call this here delta K threshold. Delta K threshold, which is coming back to what I said earlier on, which is the endurance limit of the material containing a crack. And fortunately enough, this happens. And we have many structures with cracks that have become dormant. And how can this happen? For example, you remember what I showed you yesterday, thin panels with stiffeners, and stiffeners can act as crack stoppers. Or other areas with lower stresses. And this explains the notch effect. And now doing a little detour, which is not in your handout, we saw that notches reduce the fatigue life, the endurance limit. And people said, okay, I do the test. I mean, this is supposed to be a very small notch for a specimen. I use the nominal stress, and of course, there is a stress razor. I do the analysis not with the nominal stress, but with the local stress here. Okay? And then the stress here that leads to non failure should be identical with the endurance limit of the smooth specimen. Because it is here the failure happens. And usually in design we deal with maximum stress. We go to the stress peak and design with that maximum stress. Okay. That didn't work. The life was better than predicted by the notch acuity and the notch factor. And once again, mystery, how can we explain that, how we can we understand it? And in the end, it was fracture mechanics. So this is the local stress. It approaches the nominal stress here. And cracks started here and propagated for a while. And obviously, fatigue limit was indeed lower than the local stress. But the crack stops somewhere here in a decreasing stress field. So it's a stress shadow, so to speak, something like that. And when you do it carefully, you do a careful analysis, you will see that this is identical with the threshold stress intensity factor here.
where you can really play around with this threshold value and do quite good estimates of fatigue levels. So fracture mechanics helps understand what happens in cases we, at first glance, we don't understand. Okay, so this is the endurance limit of a structure of cracks. A component can have long cracks, there are many bridges, deep bridges with long cracks that propagated and got some stuck somewhere. At the other end of the curve, we can do tests with higher load amplitudes, but then we have to reduce the frequency, otherwise the crack will run too fast and we can't measure it properly. And we end up with another hook here. So in the end, this thing is kind of an S-shape. And we distinguish between three different regions. Here is one, two, there is four, and this is, of course, three. So this is how we determine the end diagram. And there are more traps that I'm coming to later. And there are various ways to look at fatigue. And I'm showing you another one, which ends up with the so-called Kitagawa diagram. And this is the following thing. Here is, it has to do with threshold. Here we have the logarithm of the crack size and logarithm of applied stress. Now we remember the basic formula of the stress intensity factor, delta K is delta sigma times square root I A times our wave function. Now for the threshold condition, we have here threshold. We can solve the equation for delta sigma threshold or the fatigue limit, which is delta K threshold divided by square root of crack size and y function if there is any. And this gives us a straight line here. So this represents the equation. But this doesn't go up to infinity. The limit is given, you see, this is shrinking crack size. It's getting smaller and smaller, it's a logarithmic scale. And finally, we should here end up at the endurance limit, that we call it sigma sub capital E. And somehow, we get a combined curve which is given by macro crack propagation here and the endurance limit of the material. And down here, we have non-propagating cracks. And why did the endurance limit or the ascent curve this is our ascent curve down here we have non-propagating cracks and also here this is the area of non-propagating cracks and this is something that I have in a somewhat nicer diagram. A Okay. So this is the AGL diagram, and with a, you see an S shape, it lies on the blackboard. And fortunately, here we have a power law relationship, and the exponent is usually metals between 2 and 4. So the steels are more around 2 or a bit more than 2, and the lightweight alloys more towards 4. And this tells us that the current propagation rate increases in the second to fourth power of the applied stress. So reducing the applied stress in a component is a very effective manner for extending life if there is a crack. An existing crack or an assumed crack. Now this is again the Kitagawa diagram. You see the endurance limit and the threshold equation. So these are the three sketches that I want to make you aware of. This is three different ways looking at fatigue. And like I said yesterday, if you have different tools for investigating something, use them all, and you always learn something. And here is the microcrack propagation, including non-propagating cracks, and the endurance, the SN curve, sorry, cracks propagating. And I hate it when there is a dark background and the black fonts can be red. On my screen here, it comes beautifully, but I have to learn from that that I. Future presentations, I reduce the strength of the color because the projection by NEMA doesn't make it any better. Okay, so this is a red is the region of crack propagation, and gray here is the region of non-propagating. Okay. Here we see a bunch of materials. My colleague Roman Bejer worked hard on this work here, on these crack propagation studies. It looks a bit awkward, but I'm trying to explain to you what we have here. This is steels, here if you have steels, symbols, here goes down here. Here we have fuel cutter. Interestingly, this copper alloy here has a high threshold, and at high crack propagation rates, it is as high as steels. And titanium is between steels and aluminum. So that's kind of a very vague kind of an order by the modulus of elasticity. The higher the modulus, the lower the crack propagation rate. If you would do the measurements on tungsten, the rates would be even lower. And when people ask, why don't you make aeroplanes of steels? Crack propagation rate is so low. It is nonsense, of course, because the density of the material is so high. And it is obviously here, copper, this alloy should normally be located here, situated here. This is obviously the microstructure. This has a very strange microstructure, and this microstructure is a very effective means of reducing the crack propagation rate. So it's a bit awkward here, but there is some order visible. Yeah, once again, what I showed you yesterday, the strength obviously doesn't play a role in terms of fatigue cap propagation. And this is one steel with student heat treatment. This was a number of steels between 250 and almost 700 MPAs. And I can't repeat this often enough. There is no systematic effect. And please do never ever replace your material by a higher strength material if there is a risk of having fatigue cracks. You reduce the life by second or fourth power, the applied stress. But it's much more effective to reduce the applied stress or to use a totally different material. This is the models of elasticity, very schematical, very rough. And there is another thing that bothers us. And I would like to explain this in detail in a moment. R is the stress ratio. Minimum stress divided by maximum stress, or minimum stress intensity factor divided by maximum stress intensity factor, which is the same thing. And what do we have here? A factorographic observation on an aluminum alloy. And here we have a stress fatigue crack propagation curve for stress ratio R equal to zero. It's two-thirds, it has a higher rate here. And what I have plotted here, the rates are given by the lines. What I have plotted here is what we call fatigue striations on the fracture surface. These lines here, like a washboard here, right? And these lines indicate successive positions of the fatigue crack. And which means we believe that during every load cycle, the fatigue crack propagates stepwise by the width of such a striation here. This observation was possible also in the late 60s using transmission electron microscopy. And this gives us a means of failure analysis. And we have a failed part. Unfortunately, not in every material the striations look so nice. It's mainly aluminum alloys and stainless steels. Should you have a failed part from any kind of crash, and the fracture surface is still kind of undamaged, and you put it into the electron microscope, if you're lucky enough, you can see the striations and measure the striations. That's what I have done here. You see the full circles are for r equal to zero, and the open circles for r equal to two-thirds. And they correspond roughly with the macroscopic crack propagation rate. No longer here, but here we have an additional effect. So, which I'm explaining in a moment. We have a method which helps us searching for the cause of failure. We know the local crack propagation rate, and then we have to find the spot where the crack started. Then we can correlate the local fatigue crack propagation rate with the actual crack size. And if we have a diagram, crack propagation diagram for the material under investigation, then we can get a rough estimate of the applied stress. Okay. So the operator can't lie anymore, and sometimes structures are overloaded as compared to the specification. You know? And people believe, oh, it's okay, nothing will happen, and nothing has happened during the past 20 years. Nothing will happen in the next 20 years, and if it happens, people tend to try to lie, of course. But here you can have, not in all cases, of course, but if you're lucky, you can have a very good proof of what had happened in the reconstructed accident. Now, why does the correlation fail here? At high rates, the stress intensity factor becomes so high that it's getting close to initiation of stable crack propagation we learned about yesterday in the R curve. You know, the K initiation, and the crack started to propagate via these breaking inclusions. And the first indications can be seen here. So this picture was taken at high propagation rates, and if you go further, you see more and higher percentage of these broken inclusions, which increases the crack propagation rate as compared to these little striations here. So this is another method to get closer to what happened in a failure case. And in the assessment chapter tomorrow, I will keep saying, and I'm saying it now here, should you ever be in the situation of judging a failure case, please look at the broken parts. Unfortunately, there are cases when the broken parts are not available or when the operator refuses to give them away. This happened to me. I had a failure investigation for a company and a producer of something, and the operator refused to show me the broken parts. I would have liked to put them into the scanning electron microscope to make my own judgments, because the broken parts can be eye-opening. And I had another failure case where different a number of experts were asked for their opinion about the reason of the failure case. They came to different conclusions, and I should act as kind of a judge for all these investigations. And in the end, it showed that the colleagues did correct analysis, although they were false, correct analyses based on assumptions that were correct for the operation of that thing, of that structure. But during service, something happened that changed the loading from load control to displacement control. It can also happen under fatigue, you know. It changes the picture totally. So please, and for this, a look at the broken parts was necessary. Once again, should you have to investigate any kind of failure of engineering components, don't raise your hand unless you have seen the broken parts. Okay, so this is this here. Yeah, this shows how we do evaluate an A over N diagram. Some people do it point-wise or stepwise. Delta A divided by delta N, which should not be done because every measurement error gives you variability in your result. It is sheer rubbish. Don't do that, because there are cases when you have negative crack propagation rates which you can't show on the logarithmic diagram. So these points disappear and they show that something was not 100% okay during the analysis or the measurement. So it's much better to put a polynomial through number of adjacent data points, say standard, it's the M standard for that, how to do it. And you see here, scatter is much greater here than in this case. And there's another thing, materials scatter. It has happened that when you take a long rolled aluminum sheet, high-strength aluminum, and you do a fatigue crack propagation test at the beginning of the sheet and at the end, there can be a factor of 3 in crack propagation rates. So this is not experimental scatter, it's variability throughout the material. This is shown here, and also this line is 5 producers of nominally the same material. So whenever you buy a material according to specifications, even if it meets the specifications, you have different producers, you can end up with these results, which is frustrating. Okay. What's this? Okay. I want to stop here for the moment. sorry for the mess. It would have been much better to have the screen. The screen and the blackboard in parallel twice. The screen doesn't like. Here is time, here is sigma, we can have a load cycle here, and the same amplitude down here, which means that the R ratio here is higher than down there. We need to do fatigue hyperpropagation tests under these two test conditions, and then we will have a diagram, logarithm of delta K, and logarithm of dA dN. For the low R value, we may receive this diagram. For the higher R value, we may receive this diagram. So this is disturbing. After the discovery of Fort Paris, the world was in order, everything was okay. It is delta K, the variation of the stress intensity factor of the crack driving force, that matters. And that was also a theoretical background, because we know fatigue is a consequence of cyclic plastic deformations. On a smooth specimen, as I tried to explain to you a few minutes ago, it's the dislocations that leave the material and in the end lead to a kind of a nano surface roughness, which in the end then leads to microcracks. Something similar should happen at the crack tip, so the cyclic plastic deformations at the crack tip, by whatever mechanism, but the cyclic plastic deformations should be the driving force for a fatigue crack. And the cyclic plastic deformations are a direct function of delta K. That is a simple theory that can be very easily correlated, these two quantities. And Jim Rice did that in the 70s, very, very beautiful paper. And it doesn't work anymore. So this is, you know, I'm coming to more, I'm sorry, but sometimes I have to make a big detour. This is a general thing in science. It has to do with kind of perception and cognition or psychological problems. Whenever we find something, that's it, that's the truth. Now we've got it. The brain researchers, they find, they make beautiful colored pictures from your brain, you know. Now I know where your sensations are, where happiness and what are is, you know. And now we know that you don't have a free will or whatever. This is bullshit. It is wrong. It is wrong. We may have found a little bit of the truth, but not the whole picture. But people become euphoric, which is natural, of course. You know, it's, now we know it. Now we've got it. And it's wrong. We should always keep in mind that it is very little that us humans can do and can find. It is always just a little bit of the whole picture. The same is happening over and over and over again. Think of the history of cosmology. Same thing. Okay, so everything was, there is a mysterious effect of the maximum stress, which is higher at a higher R ratio, or whatever it is. No, in the end, the original theory was proven to be all right. And
This brings me to another point. Whenever you do an experiment, collect as much information as possible. Do not just do a single kind of measurement. Measure and observe as much as possible. This helps. Now, Wolf Elmer. Have the same attitude. He had a specimen, CT specimen, and he measured the relative motion of the crack fence. It's not in your hand out here. The relative motion of the crack fence near the crack tip. Or you can do it with the back face, strain gauge here. But this is not so sensitive as the one here. You can use these little electric strain gauges or little clip gauge. And what he found was eye-opening. So what he did is he applied a certain force onto his specimen, and here the strain or displacement beam, whatever it is, doesn't matter. And when he unloaded the specimen, it went down a straight by a straight line according to the compliance of the specimen. The specimen has a certain compliance, which is deformation normalized by stress or force. So this is the elastic compliance, for which you also have formulas as a function of crack size. The longer the crack, the greater the compliance. So this is a long crack, this is a short crack, okay? And then you got a knee, the crack became shorter, which can't be. Unfortunately, we don't have crack healing effects. This would have meant that the crack had been healed. It had become shorter. And very quickly, he found an explanation. The crack is partly closed. The crack is open, and when you unload, then usually from the tip on, it's partly closed. So the obvious compliance becomes smaller and it looks as if the crack were shorter. And it is indeed shorter under compression. So that was the explanation. So here the crack is closed. So this is a crack closure effect. If I were rich, I would give a donation to the university for a nice backward arrangement here, up and down, and whatever. Unfortunately, I'm not wealthy enough. And this can be easily expanded to the load cycle. And I came here. So obviously down here the crack is closed, and which in turn means that it's only this part of the crack of the stress intensity factor that is really effective as a crack firing force. And that's why we call this delta K effective. The downside is, the positive side is, now we have an explanation. I'm showing you an example at the moment that it really works. And the downside is, on the negative aspect, we need experiments to determine it for the moment. But later, it came out that it can also be predicted. So, the idea is, had we
It's a crack closure point. But you could calculate it and okay, exactly for the various R values, and the world would be okay again, and we would have identical delta K diagrams. For example, we have two here. Can be transferred to a unique diagram. There is a split at the upper end of the diagram because it is here where the maximum value of K approaches the critical value of the vector calculus. So there is also an exact physical explanation that at the upper end the diagrams must split. But usually of interest is the diagram down here where the crack propagates during most of the lifetime. So this letter K effect, sorry, so this is it. And why do we have crack closure? I can tell you thousands of publications, including from our lab, thousands of publications have been produced to explain the mechanisms of crack closure. There is three explanations that make sense. And the first one that springs to mind is what we call plasticity induced closure. And the idea behind this is the following: when we crack propagates by one load cycle, then the material at the very tip, the very crack tip, is plastically stretched. So there is a remaining deformation. And when I unload, these the two parts get in contact, the broken parts, and this gives a little wedge in the crack and leads to crack closure. And this happens, of course, thousands of times. So we have a kind of a residual plastic deformation that leads to crack closure upon unloading. I have problems with this explanation. Unfortunately, don't have a better one. Using this criterion of residual plastic deformations can be used to predict the amount of crack closure even during variable amplitude loading, which is a huge step forward. Okay? So Jim Newman from NASA has set up brilliant software for that. But I have problems. What is happening, at least at low and intermediate crack propagation rates, is not fracture tests. It is shearing off mechanisms and not tensile tests, miniature tensile tests. This is not what's happening. So I must admit I can't bring these two together. Number one, that it is possible to predict the amount of crack closure using this model. And number two, it does not coincide with what we observe. I have no solution for that. Now there is another one. It is oxide induced. Oxide induced closure. And this is something that, in my view, makes sense due to the oxidation of the You know, when you cut copper grains, you always create a little bit of fresh metal surface. And fresh metal surface is extremely reactive. And so we have very thin layers of kind of reaction products. And this can lead to cut. And even a corrosive environment can be even harder. So offset heat exposure is in principle okay. And but there's a third one. It is called roughness. Roughness induced closure. And it happens in coarse grained materials. And it was an idea by Lütjering, but in the end it could be proven by fractography. When you have a coarse grained material, the fracture surface may look magnified, may look like this here, okay, have a zigzag, very simple model. The mating surface here, here's a crack tip. Now upon loading and unloading, the idea is that, at least when you have a CT specimen, the crack does not only open, there's also a slight shearing effect in crack propagation direction, or in the crack plane. And so when we unload, the upper side may move a little bit. It's not very much, but much is needed. To the left, for example, the other one to the right, and then you get contact here. And indeed, Lütjering found when he used the same material that in fine grain size condition and a coarse grain size, the coarse grain leads to high substantial crack closure effects. So this is a very quick walk through the crack closure effect. And oh yeah, let's look at a few slides again now. Down place here.
Okay.
These are measurements using gas latitude in delta K, it's full delta K, and here is delta K effective. And here is some divergence, which is physically explainable. Because the K-max value here is higher than there, so the K-max reaches fracture toughness at smaller delta K values. This is a diagram donated by Alfred Binot, and he had a number of materials here. Titanium, I don't know what this is here, titanium aluminide, titanium aluminum, and vanadium alloy, and so on and so forth here, stainless steel. And when he normalized the effective stress intensity factor with the modulus of elasticity, I showed you previously that the modulus of elasticity has a strong effect. The greater the modulus, the lower the crack propagation rate. And such diagrams, when they collapse, and the different curves collapse by a specific normalization, then we know, we have found the right, the most important parameters. Okay, so this is how it works. I think it's a very nice diagram, and I'm very grateful to you that you gave me this diagram. Here we have the Perry's law, which is a straight line in double logarithmic scales. And it would be very nice if we could have an equation that covers the whole S shape of the curve. And this can be easily done by arithmetic fitting around, we call it. So there is no physics behind it, just a little bit of math. Dozens of equations have been created. This is the usual, the original Paris equation. And you can force the crack propagation rate down to zero at the threshold when you subtract the threshold value from the total delta K. Then when delta K approaches delta K threshold, the rate becomes zero, so you get the downturn. And the upswing can be done by using this fitting around here when delta K approaches delta K critical, this is delta K critical here, then the denominator becomes zero, the whole term is shooting up to infinity. Okay. So it's just fitting around. It is, and I can promise you almost every equation does it. But so many authors wanted to have their own equation. Okay. So this is my own measurement here. It's the two diagrams, the two stress crack propagation curves I showed you previously with the striations. Just plotted as a function of delta K, medium strength aluminum alloy, and here you see as a function of delta K effective, everything collapses. Wonderful. Makes people happy. Okay. And then there's something else, but I'm suggesting to have a break because I see you getting tired. The first one's fall asleep. And once again, please feel free to interrupt me, to ask me questions. You see a mistake that I'm making on the blackboard. Just interrupt me, and we are a small group, no problem. You don't have to be shy. That's no stupid question. So